Welcome everyone to the 17th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. And our second item today is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on Audit Scotland's NHS in Scotland 2021 report. And this follows an evidence session the committee undertook with the Auditor General for Scotland on the 19th of April 2022. And I'd like to welcome to the committee Hamza Youssef, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. And he's joined by his officials, Richard McCallum, Director of Health, Finance and Governance, Gillian Russell, Director of Health Workforce, and John Burns, the Chief Operating Officer of NHS Scotland. Good morning to you all. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Convener. I hope you and committee members are all safe and well. Good to be around the table where all of us are present in person as well. So really good to see everybody. Really grateful for committee for the time this morning. I can be relatively brief in my opening statement. I suspect most of the issues we will give a thorough exploration of those issues. Can I thank Audit Scotland first and foremost for their report into the NHS. It was informative, it was insightful. I think it was fair in terms of its recognition of the efforts that the government has made, but also fair on where they think the government and partners must go further in terms of our response, particularly to the pandemic. The report correctly identifies that health and social care in Scotland is at a very critical juncture indeed. We're navigating our way out of the pandemic while dealing with case numbers that place continuing pressure on the NHS. And it's not just current case numbers, it is the accumulative impact, of course, of the pandemic over the last 2 years, which continues to put pressure on our health services. In addition, we've seen the emergence of new challenges such as long COVID, which is having complex detrimental effects on people's lives. And we'll be able to say more about that, of course, no doubt in this session, but also in the parliamentary debate taking place in this forthcoming parliamentary debate in this later this month. There are also challenges caused by the knock-on impacts of the pandemic. We know that we must address the backlog in treatment and care. We must support our workforce, both in health and social care, and ensure that everybody can access primary care in a way that supports them and addresses their clinical needs. Addressing these challenges will require a significant change and changes to the way we deliver health and social care in Scotland, while of course maintaining access to these vital services. As Audit Scotland report notes, our workforce has kept going in incredibly difficult circumstances. And I want to thank, as I'm sure everybody else around this table would, thank our health and social care workers from across Scotland for the invaluable work that they have done, their tireless efforts throughout this pandemic. I recognise the monumental challenges they've faced. Every single health and social care worker I've spoke to has told me that the last couple of years have been the most difficult in their professional careers. And that's why we've made £12 million available to support workforce wellbeing and put in place a national wellbeing helpline to support staff 24/7. When it comes to recruitment of staff, we're making significant progress. Members of the committee will be aware of our recent announcement where we've recruited almost 200 nurses internationally and many in the pipeline as well. That's in addition to the 1,000 additional support staff to work across the NHS and social care. But more progress is needed, and that's why we're taking the necessary steps to ensure that we recruit more staff, but also crucially, not just recruitment, what we can do to retain staff right across the NHS and social care. Audit Scotland made clear that both healthcare and social care should be as inclusive and accessible as possible. Last year, we ran the General Practice Access campaign, which was shared across social media sites as well as across radio for 5 weeks to reassure the public that general practices were open. This emphasised a variety of ways that treatment can be sought, including, of course, face-to-face, but also video and telephone consultations too. Outside of general practice, we're continuing to develop a range of primary care services available, including, for example, NHS Pharmacy First Scotland and NHS 24, which I'm delighted recently celebrated its 20th birthday. We're also developing more online resources through NHS Inform and indeed other challenges. The way in which we access services is changing and going to change. As our digital behaviours change and in accordance with clinical needs, By prioritising clinical resources, we are both managing demand and hopefully supporting people more effectively. Audit Scotland in the report rightly identified the importance of gathering and sharing health data to help ensure transparency and the provision of effective joined-up care right across the health and social care landscape. We have also committed to publishing a dedicated data strategy for health and social care that will be the first for Scotland, and that we hope to publish that by autumn, of this year. This is backed by the Scottish Government investing £112.9 million in the digital health and care over 22-23 to help utilise and make the best use of digital technologies in the design but also in the delivery of our services. The NHS Recovery Plan, backed by over £1 billion of investment, set out our plans for health and care over the term of this Parliament. That includes over £400 million to create a network of national treatment centres right across Scotland, increasing capacity for planned elective procedures, but also diagnostic care. We are increasing NHS capacity by at least 10% as quickly as possible to address the backlog of care and meet ongoing needs, healthcare needs across the country. Convener, to conclude, we're still dealing with the pandemic. It isn't over yet. This pandemic continues to have profound effects on the health of our nation and, of course, on health services up and down the country. Our focus must be on ensuring that we transition out of this pandemic safely and in tackling the backlogs in immediate and essential care that have resulted. However, we must also provide access to care in a way that best suits people's needs. We need a strong workforce where well-being is protected, recruitment and retention is at extremely high levels. We need to adapt to ensure that new technologies and models of working can help support more of our citizens in their care as close to home as possible. That is my aim as Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, and I look forward to delving into these issues in more detail, and of course happy to take your questions, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thanks for that summary. My colleagues will be asking questions on quite a lot of the detail of what you've talked about, and not just, I guess, the Audit Scotland report, but some of the Audit Scotland report really dovetails quite nicely into some of the findings that we've had in previous inquiries that we've done, particularly around workforce. So I imagine that quite a few of my colleagues might bring up some of this more specific stuff from our inquiries around alternative pathways, perinatal mental health. But I want to ask you about the care and wellbeing portfolio and really get a status report on where we are with that. But also, if you can maybe, one of the things that's been mentioned in the Audit Scotland report is about the sustainability of the NHS and social care as it currently stands, or even before the pandemic, and how the care and wellbeing portfolio might improve that sustainability in the future, if you could, Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And in terms of your first comment, of course, I'll take any questions that the committee wishes to ask, and where we can give you the detail today, we'll give you the detail, of course, and as always, I'll provide you further written detail if that is required. But look, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, I thought the NHS, the Audit Scotland report on the NHS was a fair one. I thought it was a fair summary of the challenges. It was it really highlighted, I think, the efforts that the government has had to make in this extraordinary period. They will write about this period and learn about it in our schools and in our history books and modern studies classes and so on and so forth for, well, long past since any of us will be around, I suspect. It was an extraordinary period, and I want to again commend all of those involved for their extraordinary efforts during that period. In terms of your specific question about the care and wellbeing portfolio, yes, it'd be fair to say that the work on the care and wellbeing portfolio has been affected by the pandemic. There's just no doubt about that. One of my lead officials, my key officials, director, in fact, joint director in relation to that portfolio, actually was working on the test and protect system for us. So, you know, we had to move resources crucially away from various different parts of government to focus on the pandemic response. But officials, it's very much in developmental stage. Officials are working to the defined intended scope. There are a number of work streams which I will touch upon in a second. We're very clear that the work of the care and wellbeing portfolio has to be broader than just healthcare. So how they interact with other portfolios, other departments and government is going to be crucial. The first meeting of the internal care and wellbeing portfolio board did take place late last month, so at the end of April. In terms of that sustainability question which you asked, I think it was absolutely on the money, that question. The care and wellbeing portfolio, such a key element of that will be on the preventative side. And we've talked in this committee, I've spoken many times about the importance of that agenda. It's a crucial, vital part of our recovery, our renewal of the NHS and social care moving forward. And the care and wellbeing portfolio has got to be critical to that. And that will help to make our services more sustainable. Because if we can, of course, keep people out of going into our hospitals, into our acute sites, if they do have to go there, keeping them there for as little a time, as short a time as possible, then that is to, of course, their benefit, but also, frankly, helps to make our services more sustainable. One of the portfolio approach is still being developed, but you know, has three primary objectives: coherence, sustainability, and improved outcomes. So that sustainability question that you ask, it is one of its key principle objectives, as well as prevention. Care and wellbeing portfolio will also have a big focus on innovation and developing the infrastructure that can really drive that efficiency and productivity within our health and care systems as well.
Okay, thank you. I just want to ask you one further thing about, you know, what I know we're at very early stages, but in terms of like the expectations of the public around your future healthcare and well-being. I mean, do you think we're at a point now where we really need to evaluate patient expectation about where they get their care, how they get their care, you know, where they go if they need care? I mean, the Scottish Government have put in a number of things in order, the alternative pathways, and you mentioned the NHS 24 and dialing 111 instead of turning up at A&E, etc. But do you think we've still got a lot of work to do in terms of managing people's, how they approach their own healthcare, how they approach using the NHS?
Yeah, I think, again, it's an excellent question. I mean, it is a question and an issue that I speak to regularly, particularly with the chief executives and the chairs of our health boards, who, if I'm being honest, have a real anxiety about this question. Because, look, for the rest of us around this table, life feels like it's got back to normal for most of us. We can interact with our family, we can book a holiday, we can hold a 70th birthday for our parents and have 100 people attend if we want. Life for most of us feels like it's back to normal. But life in the health service is still under extraordinary pressure. And I don't need to tell people around the room, around this table, that they know it, because you're close to this. But in one sense, people are asking, well, if my life has got back to normal, why does my health service not feel like it's got back to what it was like in pre-pandemic levels? And therefore, there's got to be honesty, and I do this to the best of my ability, certainly, but there's got to be honesty right across the board to say it is going to take not weeks, not months, but years to recover our NHS. And that is because there's been 2 years of accumulated challenge. And look, I'm not going to pretend there wasn't challenge in the health service before. There was. And those issues undoubtedly exacerbated, not just in the health service, but in care and social care in particular too. And those issues just been exacerbated unbelievably so by the pandemic. So, yes, it's important for us to be upfront, to be honest, to manage expectation, but also, you know, be ambitious. And we are ambitious. Our recovery plan, I think, is a demonstration of that ambition. The conversations I have with my colleagues at in health board level across integration authorities when it comes to social care, we all want to be ambitious, but also realistic as well. So there's a bit of further work done, and John Burns and I speak about this very regularly, but a bit more work to be done around being able to cement our delivery milestones in relation to planned care in particular, because we know how long people have been waiting for a number of elective procedures. So a bit more work to do in that, and then of course we publish that in due course. And that, I hope, will set a realistic timescale around recovery, but also an ambitious one too. But yes, I think your point's right, that there are we have to be upfront and honest about the scale of the challenge and how people might well access their services.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to talk about NHS reform in more detail. Questions from Sue Webber. Sue.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and everyone for coming along today. You've mentioned that we must change the way we deliver our health and social care, Cabinet Secretary, whilst maintaining access. And you've said also that yourself and Mr Burns are still discussing about how the recovery plan, which will demonstrate that ambition for reform, but there's still a lot to do in terms of setting milestones in concrete for your delivery plan of that. And it's been 8 months, as you've said, since the Scottish Government published the recovery plan. So what is your assessment of the progress being made, if any, since its publication? We all understand, and you've mentioned, that there is no quick fix, and we do understand that. But the statistics coming out that we see daily are bleak on A&E, cancer, delayed discharges and diagnosis. So is the plan working, and what confidence can we have in that plan?
Yeah, look, I think the question's a fair one about the recovery plan. What I would say, Ms Webber, is that it is purposely a five-year recovery plan. We will update, of course, Parliament, as the plan says. We will come forward to Parliament with a yearly update, so that update will happen when Parliament returns back from its summer recess. So we plan to give that annual update in summer, so it'll be a year on since the plan was published. What I would say, and I think, Ms Webber, you would recognise this, and I suspect everybody around the table would recognise this, is that we're not out of the pandemic yet. And not only are we not out of it, I would say that the most recent wave of the pandemic we've dealt with has been the most challenging wave of the pandemic. It has been relentless. Usually a wave, if you take the Alpha wave, you take the Delta wave of the pandemic, the original variant of COVID, we knew that a wave would hit us, and it would hit us really hard for 2 to 3 months, and then we'd be able to hopefully get out of the other side and try to recover. But we've had wave after wave after wave, and Omicron seamlessly transitioned into BA2. So we had Omicron wave that hit us around about December time, seamlessly into BA2, which was the even more transmissible variant of a sublineage of Omicron. And of course, we've only just exited that wave most recently. So a wave of about 4 to 5 months during the height of the winter pressure. And it wasn't its severity, because it was less severe, as we know, than previous variants. It was transmissibility, which just knocked out entire orthopaedic wards or wards right across the country, and hospitals up and down the country. So there's no doubt the recovery has been hampered. In terms of the recovery plan itself, though, the foundations of that recovery plan are absolutely solid. The work we're doing with the CFSD, for example, to ensure that we drive innovation. The work on our NTCs, so we hope to have a number of NTCs, National Treatment Centres, coming on board in the next 18 months. I recently announced, for example, the purchase of Carrickglen, which will not come on board in those 18 months, but it will come on board as an important and crucial national treatment centre. And then on top of that, we can see where we've had just a bit of a lull in that pressure, the ability of the NHS to recover to some degree. So, for example, the last statistics that were published, monthly statistics that were published in relation to performed operations, John correct me if I'm wrong, but we saw around about a 17% increase of performed operations. So there is the ability to recover, but I won't lie, it is going to be difficult. It will be tough. And the biggest threat to the recovery, the biggest threat, I think, by far, are future variants of the virus. But I think our recovery plan will deliver. It's why I suspect other nations of the UK that published similar recovery plans thereafter, the UK government, the Welsh government, their recovery plans were not too dissimilar to ours at all, because everybody recognises this is not going to be fixed in a year. It's going to take time.
One more. Okay. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned that the NHS is under pressure. We know that. But I would also testify, state today, that it's always under some form of pressure. And it has been in all the years that I worked in that environment before coming to Parliament. The Audit Scotland report notes that there's not enough detail in the five-year plan to determine whether its ambitions can be achieved in the timescale set out. Given the scale and complexity of the challenges facing Scotland's NHS, do you agree that much greater detail is needed if we are to get the NHS back on an even keel?
So, a couple of points, if I may. One, I don't disagree with you when you say that the NHS and social care are probably always under some element of form of pressure. But I would also say, to be fair, if you speak to anybody involved in health and social care, they will tell you the last 2 years have been unlike anything they've ever faced in their lives. I mean, I talk to nurses, doctors that have been working in the NHS for four decades, sometimes even more, and they tell me in the 40 years that they've been working in the health service, they've never experienced anything like the last 2 years. Nothing even comes close to it. So, yes, there is pressure, and then there is the pandemic pressure. And the pandemic pressure is above and beyond anything we've ever felt before. In terms of your question about more data, I think that comes across quite strongly.
It was detail, not data. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary.
So in terms of, data is an important part of the detail. I think it informs a really important part of the detail. I'll come back to the issue of more detail in a second. But I think data is crucial to that. That comes across in the NHS, in the Audit Scotland report. From the Auditor General, who says there's got to be more transparency around the data. So that will help us in terms of the detail that we bring forward. We will provide even more detail than we have, whether that's on workforce. And of course, we're waiting for workforce plans from our health boards and plan to come forward with more detail this summer in terms of the three-year projections. We'll bring forward more detail in terms of the update that we have promised to bring forward on the recovery plan this summer. And as I say, data, I think, is absolutely crucial to that. What I would say is the ambitions of the recovery plan, I think, were well recognised within the Audit Scotland report.
Thank you. Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
When I see a patient in GP and organise, say, an X-ray or put them onto the waiting list to see a hospital consultant, the first question they always ask me is, how long is the wait going to be? And I know the Audit Committee have highlighted this, along with Audit Scotland, stating, and I paraphrase, NHS boards should publish data on performance to enable transparency on how NHS boards are managing their waiting lists. That patients and doctors want to know how long patients have to wait. And so why can't we have, in the future, in the plan, indicative waiting times, which are relatively live, so that we can all go on a website and see how long we need to wait?
So that would be the plan. To have that data, I think it's a fair expectation for the patient to have. I think it's a fair expectation for whether it's GPs or those who work in our health and social care system to have. We expect to publish data around clinical prioritisation late summer this year. It's a new policy put in place to ensure that. The public, the example that you've given of your patient, will be able to hopefully see how long they would have to wait, but it will give probably a range as opposed to perhaps an exact date. We're working closely with PHS, we're working closely with boards to develop the infrastructure in order to collate and publish this data. So it's an ambition of ours to have that available in a way that's easy to find, easy to understand, both for the patient but also for the healthcare professional too.
And when do you expect that to be online?
Late summer is when we intend to publish that data. But we will have to, I think, add to it. I think we'll continue to have to make sure that it's live, it's iterative, and where we can add to it and develop it even further, we will do that. But certainly we expect that the first cut of that data to be published in relation to clinical prioritisation in late summer.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, everybody. I'm interested in the reform as part of how we come out of the pandemic. looking at technology that we have already. So we saw people adopting NHS near me really quickly, and meaning that people can have remote engagement with their doctors, whether it's their respiratory doctors or their GPs or whatever. So I'm assuming that that will still be part of the renewal and reform, is to use the technology and innovations that we've seen and continue to utilise that so that we can help support people in, you know, the way they choose to engage with their GPs and their doctors as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think we have to, we must embed that technology into our system. Some of that came out through necessity or was built up. We built upon some of that technology. So Near Me existed pre-pandemic, but of course was used significantly more during the course of the pandemic than it ever had been pre-pandemic. So yeah, absolutely. And I think this goes back to the convener's question about, you know, being upfront and honest about how we access services. So you know, we will look to increase, and we'll work with GPs to try to increase face-to-face appointments. But that hybrid model will be part of access to general practice. So telephone and video consultation will be part of that. We've also published, as I think the Ms Harper will be aware, we've published the digital health and care strategy. It was in October last year. It's available. I'm sure the committee members will have seen it. And that really speaks and goes to the heart of what our digital ambitions are around both health and social care. And as the Audit Scotland committee highlights, I'm paraphrasing slightly, of course, but it would be a wasted opportunity if we didn't embed some of those technological advances in our response and recovery to the pandemic.
Another, just a wee question. It's like bowel screening and cervical cancer screening is part of the way, if we can screen people early, you can diagnose early, and that way the treatment can be more efficient and beneficial as well. And Cancer UK had a briefing that they sent saying that statistics published in Scotland have shown that before COVID, the uptake of bowel screening had increased. So I'm, I guess I'm in support of continuing to look at how we can improve uptake of bowel screening and cervical cervical screening, but I know that self-sampling for cervical cancer is in the pipeline as well for the future.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this could be a separate kind of committee session in itself around screening. Let me first take the opportunity to, on the record, commend our colleague Edward Mountain, MSP, who I thought spoke very bravely and with great humour, actually, about his own journey in relation to bowel cancer. I managed to speak to him privately, to share my admiration for that. But what I thought was really important, the message from our colleague Edward Mountain, was that he was reminding people about the importance of returning those screening kits, because they could, you know, his early diagnosis could save your life. Mm-hmm. And of course, we wish him all the best in his recovery. So, screening hugely significant, and probably the most difficult decision that government had to make in the course of this pandemic, or certainly one of the most difficult, was the decision to pause screening very early on in the pandemic for those few months. Recovering screening, recovery of screening is a really important part of our recovery plan, and there's some elements of it that, for example, aren't fully recovered. So if I think about the self-referral for breast cancer for women 71 plus, we're working on recovering that by September this year. For example, there's still work to do. I think it goes back to, of course, the use of digital, but also making sure that screening is accessible as close to your home as possible, and that's really important in our remote, rural and island communities. So having those mobile screening units that go around the country, for example, for breast cancer screening, is going to be really important for cervical cancer screening, to ensure that is as accessible as possible, as close to home as possible, I think is going to be key to help us in our recovery.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
We're going to focus now on workforce planning, although we have alluded to it many times before, but specific questions from David Tons.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, to all other members. Audit Scotland's report around staff and recruitment stated it would be challenging due to the historical difficulties faced by NHS in the past. Is the Cabinet Secretary confident that National Workforce Strategy will be able to meet the workforce availability and workforce wellbeing needs of the NHS?
Yes, I'm confident of that for a couple of reasons. First and foremost, on the wellbeing aspect that you mentioned, the Audit Scotland report, I'm pleased, again, recognise the focus that the government had put on wellbeing, and that is something that we're going to have to continue to do so. It's in paragraph 89 of the report. There's a clear commitment at the Scottish Government and NHS board level to support staff wellbeing, and it features prominently in the NHS recovery plan. So, you know, the fact that Audit Scotland have recognised that to me speaks volumes. I'm absolutely unapologetic about the focus that's put on this, because when it comes to issues of retention, I think staff wellbeing is at the core of it. Of course, pay, terms, conditions, all these things are important, but those who are telling me they're thinking of leaving the NHS or social care are telling me that it is the wellbeing pressures, that it is the mental health pressures that are forcing them to think about whether to leave the profession. And that, to me, is I'm desperate to try to avoid people leaving for that reason, and so wellbeing will be central. In terms of our workforce strategy, which was recently published, and remember it was co-produced with COSLA, which is really obviously important, particularly for the social care aspect, it is going to be challenging. There's no getting away from that. There are we will do everything we can to try to ensure that we increase the where necessary, the pipeline of students coming through, in particular staffing cohorts. We'll do what we can to recruit domestically. That will be a significant part of our strategy. And then there will be the international recruitment, which is not a panacea, but certainly I think will help to bolster some of that workforce. But it will be difficult because there are some specialities, for example, where there's not just a Scottish shortage, but a global shortage. Medical oncology, for example, there's an international challenge in that respect. And of course, we're not the only health service in the world that is facing these challenges. So we're all going to be looking to try to recruit more nurses and so on and so forth. So it will be that will be challenging. And data, I know, again, this is an issue that the Audit Scotland report focuses on in quite a lot of detail. We've got to make sure the data supporting our plans around workforce is accurate a projection as it possibly can be.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I was just coming to that. It's how the impact and implementation of a strategy is going to be monitored, evaluated and reported on.
Yeah, it will be. Of course, we will do that. But we will... at the moment, the current plans are to receive those updated projections from our local health boards. Then, of course, we will undoubtedly publish in more detail what our projections around the workforce will be. We'll continue to make sure Parliament is regularly updated. I'm sure those workforce plans will be regularly scrutinised by, I suspect, this committee, let alone the Chamber as a whole. It's our ambition to be as transparent and open, and be really transparent and open about the challenges too. I've just articulated some of those, obviously, to Mr. Torrance, but I think we should be upfront that this is ambitious, and but it will be also be challenging.
Cabinet Secretary, Brexit and UK immigration policy, how has that affected the NHS and its ability to recruit additional staff? And you mentioned earlier you recruited 200 nurses internationally. Have they faced any difficulties in being able to do that?
So, again, I mean, I've tried not to stray into politics too much. I mean, Brexit has undoubtedly had an impact, and I think that's, again, recognised by anybody who's involved, particularly in social care. I think anybody who's even as an MSP visited their care homes in their constituencies over the past year will have seen the differences in relation to the demographics of the workforce. And any social care provider you ever speak to, whether it's a small dependence, whether it's the third sector, whether it's local authorities who have in-house provision, I think all of them that I've ever spoken to have said that clearly Brexit has an impact. And in fairness, on the flip side of that, I was pleased that the UK government, after I think considerable pressure from the Scottish government and also the Welsh government, but also I think I suspect from providers in England too, made changes to their shortage occupation list in relation to social care. as well. But it doesn't go far enough. And social care is a real concern of mine when I talk about workforce. And of course, we've got ambitious plans around the National Care Service, and no doubt in future sessions we'll get into the detail of that. But we can't wait until the National Care Service becomes fully operational at the end of this parliamentary term. So we're taking action now, and we have to take action now. But yes, there's no getting away from challenges of decisions that are made elsewhere, but having an impact here in Scotland.
Just on the other side of things, I'm obviously our homegrown workforce, our future workforce, people want to go into a profession. The Scottish Government's obviously had put in place bursaries for paramedics, nurses and midwives. Is there any analysis of the impact that that's had in terms of actually encouraging people into profession?
Well, we've got, again, really positive data around the increase in student intake in nurses and midwives. That's been positive. And that data, I think, speaks for itself. I think it would be very difficult to say, because we have the bursary, that there's been an increase. But certainly, I think it would be fair to say the package of support that we give to students, including bursaries, has been a factor in that. But there's also challenges. And the paramedic bursary is a really good example. It was an excellent campaign run by a number of student paramedics. When I met with some student paramedics, they were very clear that without the bursary, they didn't think they could continue. So the anecdotal data is absolutely there. The workforce numbers that we have in relation to student intake is positive. But there's also some areas where historically we've struggled in terms of intake as well. And they're well known and well rehearsed. My concern, I suppose, is we know, we've talked often about the level of vacancy, for example, in our nursing cohort in particular, and we'll work hard to fill those nursing cohorts. But we're in a really competitive place because people in health systems right across the world are looking to do exactly the same. I think Scotland's a very attractive proposition, the best paid staff across the UK, I think, all over Scotland, there's an excellent lifestyle, but I think, particularly in remote, rural, and island Scotland, there's a real attraction for a lifestyle that many people seek. So we have to maximise every single one of these potential avenues to meet the ambitions of that plan.
Thank you. I'm going to pass on to Paul Kane.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I heard the Cabinet Secretary's answer, his initial answer to David Torrance on workforce pressures, and indeed his last answer there in terms of Brexit. But when we had the Auditor General before committee giving evidence, he spoke about the historic problems in terms of staffing. He said that we know and have previously reported that the NHS has historically struggled to achieve all of its staffing ambitions. So would the Cabinet Secretary acknowledge that there has been something of a historic failure and a historic challenge to deliver a workforce plan, and indeed that there have been failures to meet staffing targets pre-pandemic?
So I think we've got a good record on NHS staffing. We've grown the NHS workforce by over 28,500 under this government, or certainly since September 2006. 10 years of consecutive growth, record staffing across medical and dental consultants, nursing and midwifery, allied health professional groups too, best paid staff. So I think our record is good. But on the flip side of that, I think there have been challenges around our workforce planning and the projections, which can be difficult at any time, incredibly difficult and blown, frankly, off course when you're hit with a pandemic. There's no doubt about that. So that's why the projections that we will get from health boards and the data that we expect to receive from health boards this summer will be hugely important to try to ensure that as best as possible our workforce plans meet the demands for future years on our health service. It might be worth me bringing in John Russell, obviously, as the Director of Health and Workforce, who will be able to speak or add more to that if Mr O'Kane is happy with that.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps just To continue the point about the planning that we've asked for. So we've asked health boards to provide us with projections for workforce based on population need. And I think that is something that will give us a much better understanding of the nature of workforce that we will need for the future. There was good work done back in 2019. We did publish for the first time an integrated workforce plan, which was across health and social care. And I think it is important as we look ahead that we continue to hold both health and social care workforces together and plan on the basis of the totality of integrated workforce that we need. So the planning around the summer work that we'll get back, we've said we'll report on later in the year. And I think it's important when looking at the workforce strategy that we've just published, that the strategy itself sets a long-term framework for the workforce, but within that strategy there is clear commitment to a delivery plan that will look short, medium and long-term, and it's within those short, medium and long-term actions that you will start to see the delivery of that strategy, and that's the thing that we'll be reporting on a regular basis. So what you'll start to see is some of the work that we're doing now, for example, those workforce projections, will start to drop into the delivery parts of the workforce strategy as we move forward. And obviously that's the sort of thing that we will be reporting on to this committee and others as we move into the future. I hope that's helpful.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if I might just continue in that vein in terms of, I think, across the piece, and we've seen evidence from this in the audit report around data and planning perhaps not being adequate. And I think what that answer suggests to me is that we have to do a lot more in terms of understanding and profiling where we are. I wonder if I can just return to the Cabinet Secretary in terms of nursing places and nursing vacancies. We know that there are 6,674.4 whole-time equivalent nursing and midwifery vacancies in the NHS. We've heard, I think, some of the reasons that the Cabinet Secretary would offer in terms of the challenges that are there. But would the Cabinet Secretary also accept that over many years, the reduction in nursing training places, for example, a decision taken by his predecessor, has exacerbated the situation in terms of the challenges that exist?
Yeah, I appreciate what Paul Kane is trying to do, but I will go back to what I think is a really good record of this government.
I'm trying to ask you a question and get the answer.
Over the course of our time in government, and I think our record speaks volumes. In terms of recruitment and trying to look into the future, or even actually looking at the present vacancies that exist, what I would say is, of course, vacancies are undoubtedly a part of expanding the workforce. You have to create vacancies in order to expand the workforce. And again, I'll be able to write the committee with more detail about what percentage of recent vacancies have come on board recently. Actually, in fact, Gillian's helpfully provided it. 77% of the nursing and midwifery vacancies reported December 2021 have been recorded in the last 3 months. And I think that's reflective of the extensive new posts that have been created. So vacancies are undoubtedly a part of that expansion of the workforce. Doesn't account for all those vacancies by any stretch of imagination. Those vacancies do give me a level of concern. But I go back to the point I've made previously. Under this government, whether it's successive health secretaries and there's a good record of increasing and expanding our staffing. What I would say is it's not just about the expansion, though. It's about retention, and the nurture pillar of our workforce strategy is key to that. But it's also about, in the reform space, about how we what we ask those that work in a health service to do. And you know, a question here about, in the future, infinitely growing our workforce. I don't think anybody would suggest that that's going to be possible to do infinitely. But what we can do is ensure that people, what we ask our workforce to do, meets the needs of the public and patients. So I think we've got a good track record. I don't doubt that there's been challenges in workforce planning in the past. And hopefully with our current strategy in place, we'll be able to mitigate some of those challenges.
A number of colleagues wanting to come in on workforce planning. So can I ask for short, sharp, succinct questions? Because I'll come to Emma first, and then I'll come to Sue.
OK, thanks, Convener. I will be quick. ScotGem programme was launched in 2018, and it's unique to Scotland. And we've just seen 54 graduates as come out of that. So that's part of the way that we're trying to address GP recruitment for rural areas as well. So quick comment on how successful ScotGem is for Scotland.
Yeah, really successful, and I suppose in taking a cue from the convener about being succinct, I think there's little for me to add to that, because Emma Harper has rightly mentioned some of the data around the ScotGem programme. I think we can build upon some of these initiatives. ScotGem, Rediscover the Joy programme, Golden Hellos, for example. The work, of course, that we're doing on the back of Professor Sir Lewis Ritchie's report in relation to Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare. I think all these initiatives are incredibly important for recruitment retention, particularly in a remote, rural and island settings.
OK, thanks.
Thank you, Convener. And I know we've spoken at length, and you mentioned retention is key. The Cabinet Secretary, research by the Royal College of Midwives is damning. It says that midwifery is at breaking point. 3 in 4 RCM members in Scotland are considering leaving their posts, while 88% are reported experiencing work-related stress. NH boards are encouraged to optimise the retention of midwives, and yet midwives are telling us that this continues to be a profession in crisis. What immediate action is the Scottish Government taking to respond to the concerns of midwives right now and to improve their retention and their health and wellbeing right now?
So I spoke to Jackie Lambert of the RCM yesterday. We had a good detailed discussion around the very points that Ms Weber references. I don't know if the staff survey is published yet or not, so I'll perhaps refrain from going into it in detail until it is published. But what I would say is that understanding, the best thing we can do, the best things we can do to try to alleviate some of those concerns is, one, control COVID transmission, because it's very clear from the staff responses that the pressure of the pandemic has been unlike any other pressure they've faced before. And so if we can control COVID pressure, it will, stop midwives from having that anxiety every day they go into a shift, whether they'll be moved to a different ward or whether they'll have the appropriate number of midwives and nurses in any given unit, any given time. So controlling transmission of COVID is going to help us alleviate that significant pressure. And then both investment in wellbeing, but also giving time to our midwives and, of course, other NHS and social care staff to access those wellbeing resources is going to be really important. So I made a commitment to the RCM that we would absolutely continue to invest in that wellbeing. And the third point, actually, they made to me quite strongly was about the importance of time for training and educational and professional development, which has, again, been impacted by the pandemic. So, again, if we control the pandemic, control community transmission, then that again begins to alleviate some of that pressure, where we can dedicate more time, or midwives can dedicate more of their time to that training and professional competency aspect.
Two more questions on workforce plans specifically. Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, where are the bottlenecks on a patient journey through the NHS?
I think there's a number of bottlenecks, given, again, the pressures of the pandemic. I think some people will, for example, say to me that their challenge is accessing primary care. So we know that there can be challenges in that respect. I think you referenced an example of a patient waiting for an X-ray, accessing diagnostic testing, waiting for elective procedures. All of that has been, or screening that we talked about previously, all of that has been impacted by the pandemic. There was no doubt challenges with waiting lists, for example, pre-pandemic, but anybody, I'm not suggesting you're saying this at all, but any suggestion that the pandemic hasn't significantly exacerbated those problems, I think would be inaccurate. So I think there's unfortunately, due to the pandemic, bottlenecks across the system.
Helen Malkin.
Thanks, Convener. Morning. In the interest of time, perhaps, maybe just a commitment even for the Cabinet Secretary on this, I just wanted to raise the important issue of the allied health professional staffing, who I think have a really important role in the reform of the NHS, but also have significant recruitment and retention problems. So, as I say, at the moment, it was just to raise it to ensure that the team did see it as an important part of the overall plan for the NHS.
Yeah, vital. There's not much for me to say other than to agree ferociously with Ms Mockin on that point. And we know how important those allied health professionals are, particularly if I think about the work we're doing with GPs and those multidisciplinary teams, for example. That's just one example of how important and vital they are. So, yes, they're clearly part of our recovery plan and part of our recovery of the NHS and social care.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to talk about long COVID and Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I'm interested in looking at how we're going to support people who have this post-COVID syndrome. So, you know, lots of different symptoms seem to be demonstrated, you know, whether it's neurovascular or cardiovascular, it's gastrointestinal, musculoskeletal. So lots of range of symptoms. So I'm wondering, What are we doing in Scotland to help support people with long COVID?
Yeah, it's a really good question. Obviously, a focus of the Audit Scotland report as well. And obviously, I'll give a response to Ms Harper, but I suspect we'll get into more detail on this in the kind of forthcoming parliamentary debate on this. So I meet with stakeholders and particularly those with lived experience of long COVID fairly regularly, not just adults, but including long COVID kids, who are an important organisation representing young people that have been affected by long-term, continue to be affected by long-term impacts of COVID. And it's fair to me that they feel that there's not consistency around the approach, both from a geographical perspective, but also in terms of various different parts of the healthcare system. So that's a key challenge they've put back to me in that respect. What are we doing to support? Well, as the member will be aware, of course, we try to provide as best guidance and as much guidance as we can to our clinical colleagues in healthcare, primary care level in particular. They will often be obviously the front door where people will go to first and foremost if they're suffering from long COVID. If I look at the notes and the same guideline, for example, it says services for people with long COVID that may be provided through integrated and coordinated primary care, community rehabilitation and mental health services. And the guideline notes that areas have different service needs and resources, so not one model will fit all areas. So there's a difference in approach taken in different parts of the country. You'll know that we announced £10 million for a long COVID fund to be spent over three financial years, and we'll soon be able to give detail of how some of that funding will be distributed. I think one of the key things we've tried to do to deal with that consistency question is the establishment of that national strategic network for long COVID. That network, although it's managed by NHS National Services Scotland, it brings together clinical experts, it brings together GPs, allied health professionals, specialists in secondary care, but most importantly, it brings together those with lived experience as well. And they're informing us in terms of how that funding should be spent, where are the gaps in provision, where are the gaps in services, etc. And the network will examine and continue to be a check on the work that we are doing collectively on the issue of long COVID. I think there's a lot more to do in this space. And the last thing I'll say on this is that clearly we are still learning about the long-term impacts and effects of COVID, and therefore we provided funding for research. In that respect, the research takes time, and that's maybe not an immediate action or not an action that we'll see an immediate result or benefit of, but certainly that research is going to be critical to our understanding of how we treat and manage long COVID in the future.
Mm-hmm. And the long COVID networking will take place virtually with clinicians and professionals. We're not necessarily talking about bricks and mortar clinics spaces. we're looking at like some virtual engagement as well, like is taking place in England as well. Is that part of how we will support people going forward?
Well, I suppose I go back to the guidance note that you know, there's not one model that fits all. So for example, if a health board wanted to set up a clinic based on, you know, the Hertfordshire model, for example, they could do that, and they would be able to do that. And again, I won't preempt any funding decisions which are still being considered, and we'll obviously make that fully public and transparent soon. I think it's up to individual health boards to understand the needs of those that they serve, what is the best model for them that they can put in place. And I mean, in some places it works exceptionally well. So I spoke to a patient, Pamela, from she was in the Greater Glasgow and Clyde area, and she had had exceptional treatment and care for the long-term effects of COVID. Couldn't speak highly enough of the physios in particular, who had helped her in the course of her care and her treatment. I've equally spoken to people who say that the support they've received has been inadequate in terms of long-term effects of COVID, and that's where we've got to make sure the strategic network ensures that there's consistency across the country. And, of course, my job is to ensure that that is resourced effectively.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's just to pick up again, across the country, we've got urban and rural and remote areas and islands, and so we do have a different geography in order to support people. So we kind of just lift and shift a model that might be used elsewhere, for instance. But I suppose we can learn from what they're doing in France and Belgium and Germany and as well.
Yeah, I think we should learn from, you know, good practice across the UK, across Europe, across the world where we can. And there will be absolutely good practice going on, and where we can replicate that, and it's appropriate to replicate that in Scotland, we will do that. But also, I have a high degree of trust in our health board colleagues to be able to deal with and treat and provide care for people with long COVID in a way that suits their particular demographic and their particular challenges, if they're remote, rural, an island in particular. So, look, this is going to no doubt be an evolving picture, and I'll continue to keep Parliament updated. The use of technology, no doubt, will be important in that, but also equally, our understanding develops through research, so too will our approach develop too, I suspect.
OK, thank you.
Desh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. I'm glad Pamela had a great experience. Unfortunately, she's a bit more of the exception rather than the rule when it comes to long COVID. And I'm glad that you also mentioned the Hertfordshire model, which actually is something that could be used throughout the country because it does a lot of its work virtually, because that's how the patients want to access the clinic. A lot of long COVID patients physically coming into a hospital, into a clinic space, they're too tired and they can't access it. So the Hertfordshire model, despite what we've heard earlier, could actually work throughout the country. And when you spoke about the guideline, may was one of the big words in the guideline. So surely we need to get to a position across Scotland where there is a clinic that GPs can refer patients into, because right now what we've got is not acceptable.
I mean, I think there's a difference of view from clinicians, and of course I would respect your clinical judgment in that respect, but there are many clinicians, I think you would acknowledge this, that have a different view, that actually a one-stop clinic that you can refer into would actually end up taking resources away from other parts of the health service, but actually we could refer people into a respiratory pathway or into a different pathway, and there's not that need for a one-stop clinic. At the same time, I accept the counter view to that, which I think I was trying to hopefully be fair in my articulation to Ms Harper, that where there are good models, and I purposely reference the Hertfordshire model, where there are models that we think can be replicated up here in Scotland, I have no issue with health boards replicating those models, implementing them, embedding them in their health board area. As I say, we will shortly be able to give detail once final decisions are made about funding in relation to the £10 million long COVID fund. And it will really, the purpose of that fund is to say, well, actually, where are the gaps in provision? And the strategic network will help with that. Where are the gaps in provision? And can the funding help to plug some of those gaps? And if a health board believes that there should be a one-stop clinic, then fair enough. But, you know, just take NHS Highland as a classic example of how challenging a one-stop shop clinic might be. Now, you can access virtually. I take your point that virtual can absolutely be a key critical part of that. But for many people, the expectation of that clinic will be able to see a clinician, go face-to-face where they can, and have a detailed conversation face-to-face. And we have to be upfront that that model, for example, may work in some areas that may not be suitable for others too.
On long COVID, can you be quick, please? Because I've got Paul wants to ask a question. We've got several other themes to get through.
Thank you. Thank you, Kavina. When the Auditor General came before us, he said that it's difficult, it will be difficult to evaluate how long COVID patients' outcomes and how they get on through the services. So with the money that's being spent, will you ensure up front that we embed a way to see how long COVID patients get on with their journey and also see and evaluate the outcomes with those outcomes published beforehand?
Yes, in terms of evaluation will be a critical part of any funding that we give, and that goes for any portfolio, but particularly keen that evaluation is embedded within any of the funding related to long COVID, because again, it's a condition that we're learning about. So can absolutely commit to evaluation, the exact timescales of that evaluation. If you forgive me, I'll take that off table and furnish you with more detail in that respect. But the evaluation itself of any funding, of any model, has got to be critical, because we are learning about long COVID day on day, day by day, week by week. So yes, the strategic network will have a role to play in that evaluation too. And I should say, you know, everybody in that strategic network is important, but those, and I think Sandy, Dr. Kahani will agree with me on this point, that the most important people are clearly those with lived experience. So that feedback loop that we have with them, for me, is crucial in terms of any evaluation.
OK. Paul Ken.
Thank you, Convener. Just on the £10 million fund, obviously it was announced in September of last year. However, no spending until the beginning of this financial year. So I think just to understand why that was and what the long-term strategy is in terms of funding this crucial work.
Yeah, so we were always upfront about the fact that it would be for the next three financial years. Obviously, we're in one of those financial years now. And the reason for taking some time was, and not to rehearse this point too often, but it was really crucial that we understood where the gaps in provision were, and that was informed by clinicians, informed by health boards, informed by those with lived experience. Excuse me. And that then allowed, of course, when we did a detailed consideration of that, that then allows health boards and others to bid in for some of that money to hopefully be able to plug some of those gaps in provision. So really important that that work was done. I'm confident that the first tranche of that money being disbursed will make a considerable improvement in regards to the experiences of people with the long-term suffering from the long-term effects of COVID. But as I keep saying, this will be a work in progress, because we're learning more and more about the condition, and therefore our approach should, as a result, develop too.
We're now going to address data, and we have questions led by David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody, again. In a conversation at a weekend with friends when we were socialising, they're all frontline staff, NHS staff, Audit Scotland's call for more data, their faces just went, because they feel that the collection of it and the time they've got to spend on it detracts them from frontline services. So where is the fine balance here? Because if Audit Scotland want more data, more data, more data, frontline services and the backlog's just going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. So how do we get a balance there?
I think it's a really good point. First of all, I'm really pleased Mr. Torrance has time to socialise. It's dreadful.
I won't tell you what I was celebrating.
quite right. And it's nice to get back out and socialising. Now that we can, of course. To the serious point in his question, There is a balance that needs to be struck. I'm very conscious of this because I've asked for a lot of data from our healthcare colleagues in the course of the pandemic in the year that I've been Health Secretary. I've asked for a lot of data, and government has asked for a lot of data, and that's put undoubtedly some level of strain. So we try to get that balance right in terms of how often reporting, what data they're reporting on, et cetera, et cetera. The key issue, I think, around data, maybe get into this in more detail, that I hear from healthcare professionals is just still some of the barriers that exist between sharing data across the health and social care landscape. And that continues to be a really significant problem. Our data strategy, our digital health and care strategy, forgive me, that was published last year, certainly lays the foundations of easing some of that in the future and removing some of those barriers. But yes, I think your point about making sure that we absolutely have the data that we need, but making sure we don't burden our health services at a time of extreme challenge is something we're very alive and alert to.
Thank you. Nope, that's it.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning.
Good morning.
Well, the forthcoming data strategy directly addressed those gaps in data identified by Audit Scotland in primary care and community care data, or is the Cabinet Secretary thinking it will be more of an overarching strategy?
So it's a really good question. So I think the gaps that we see at the moment, or the barriers that we see at the moment, and that sharing of data, that work is all to remove those barriers. That work is already taking place, so it doesn't need necessarily another strategy or another document. That issue is well known. It's issues that we've been working on for many years, and we'll continue to try to work through some of those issues. And if you look at our digital health and care strategy published last year, I was just looking at the strategy again this morning. Actually, one of the really key aspects of that strategy, one of the key aims, in fact, it's got three key aims, and the second of those key aims is around, I'll just pull it up so I don't paraphrase, the sharing of that data. So a system that allows staff to record, access and share relevant information across health and care systems, and I think that is really important, that is done in a way that, of course, removes those barriers, but also, frankly speaking, we're able to do within the financial constraints that we're under. And if I went to page, 17 or 18 of that strategy, page 18 of the strategy, it talks about our digital foundation, and it talks about the national digital platform and how the cloud-based infrastructure is going to be so, so important. So this isn't about upending every single IT system across the NHS and social care and completely replacing it in its entirety with one system, but actually using that cloud-based architecture, which can allow you to share information better. So yes, data strategy will be overarching. We'll talk about how important it is for people to be able to access their own data, of course, how that data will be safely managed, stored, ethically managed, and so on and so forth. It will also ensure that strategy, sorry, will also be an iterative strategy, so that will continue to be developed as well. But it won't delay any of the current work that's been done to address the issue of availability of data, whether that's at primary care, secondary care or community level.
And what will the data strategy do to improve data on health inequalities? We've heard in other pieces of work issues around data specifically relating to different minority ethnic groups and things like that. And it's an area that I'm quite keen that we continue to work on to make sure that everybody's healthcare matches the reality of their lives.
Yeah, yeah. I know, consistently raised this issue around health inequality when I've been in front of committee, and it's an important issue for us to focus on collectively. So a couple of points. Again, I go back to my substantial point to your previous answer, which is the work we're doing around data on health inequalities isn't going to wait for the strategy to be published. Mm-hmm. We're getting on with that work just now. So if I give you just a couple of examples, you'll know that during the vaccination programme, during the course of the vaccination programme, we ensured we collected data on people's ethnicity, for example, and that gave us much richer detail around some of those health inequalities. Very clear that the uptake of the vaccine was lower amongst particular ethnic minority groups, such as the Scottish African population, for example. I think the Scottish Polish population as well. So we're doing some of that. The other example around some of this would be the great work done by the Health Inequalities in Primary Care Short Life Working Group, and much of that work involves some of the colleagues from the Deep End project, which of course, as you know, is GP practices that are focused and based, in some of our most deprived parts of Scotland. And I would commend that report to everybody in the committee if they haven't seen it. In terms of the data strategy itself, it will absolutely set the direction for improving data collection, recording of protected characteristics data, which will allow for research into health inequalities in a great amount of detail. So there will be that element to the data strategy, but I just want to give Ms McKay absolute assurance that we're not waiting for that strategy to improve the data collection on health inequalities. That work is taking place right now.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Gillian. Talking about prevention and early intervention, although, again, we have covered some of it already, but Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, Convener. So I think everybody here would agree that improving population health is going to be really, really key going forward. Life expectancy, particularly healthy life expectancy, physical health, mental health and wellbeing. I think COVID has shown us the importance of these things as well. But we're also in a situation where we're recovering from COVID. So as the health and social care sector recovers, how can you ensure that policymaking is really, really remains focused on prevention and early intervention?
So, on that's a good question on prevention, if I can give you confidence that this is not seen in isolation in health and social care. So, of course, vitally important for us in health and social care. But the work that Deputy First Minister does in convening a group of a number of cabinet secretaries and ministers together with a great degree of regularity, that is focused on almost entirely on prevention. And our recent announcements around the Child Poverty Action Plan, for example, is I think an excellent example of a number of portfolios coming together to say we're going to work hard to deal with this issue of child poverty as it exists, but also in the preventative space to prevent further young people, children, families getting into poverty, and here's how we plan to do that. So that cross government, cross portfolio working is vital. I think improving physical and mental health before crisis point is a real important focus for us. And there's a lot of focus that goes into CAMHS, understandably so. There are challenges in around CAMHS referrals, and I accept that. And that's why we'll put in significant investment. But we're also putting a significant investment into prevention before we get to crisis point. What can we do with our schools, for example, with education and around mental health as well? In terms of physical health, again, a lot in the preventative space. How do we make physical health opportunities, sport, more accessible? Not just, it's not something just for those who are in an elite level, again, as important as that is. But, celebrated, 10 years of the Daily Mail, I think, last week. And my colleague Marie Todd has to get a shout-out for her vociferous championing of that particular project. But trying to make physical health and opportunities to improve your physical health as accessible as it possibly can. So if I can give you an assurance, an absolute assurance that we've got a laser-like focus on the preventative agenda and have done for many years. But I go back to the point that Ms McKay raised, that our data in around those areas of highest deprivation and where health inequalities, unfortunately, are still too wide, those areas are going to be areas of particular focus for us in the coming period.
Thank you. And certainly there's so much work around 20-minute neighbourhoods and everything as well, actually having services based in the communities where people are as well, and I appreciate all of that. And it's certainly one of the things that we've come up against when we've been talking to people from the NHS is the fact that, quite often as well, it's what they're targeted on that they tend to be driving towards. And actually, it can be much more difficult for them to prioritise the preventative work there. So I'm wondering, what kind of stuff can be done to empower them to ensure that work is really at the top of their priorities? And is there monitoring and evaluation that we can be looking at as well alongside that?
Yeah, so a lot of our funding streams, for example, are focused on that preventative spending. I should commend the third sector for the role that they play. We often talk about the important role of our public bodies, and of course they do play an exceptional and exceptionally important role in all of this, but I think the third sector's got a vital and critical role to play in the prevention and preventative agenda. So our funding will often be targeted in that preventative space, and of course that funding, as I've mentioned in a previous answer, will always be evaluated in terms of outcomes and what it's achieving in terms of outcomes. We also have obviously an important role in terms of the policy making and what can help in that preventative space. So if I think about some of the action we've taken around smoking cessation, around obesity, around alcohol consumption, that is, you know, our policy has to be focused in that preventative space. It's also why I'm very keen that when we talk about health and social care, we don't lose focus of the social care aspect, because I think the more we can resource our social care and care in the community, then we hopefully prevent people from coming in the front door of our hospitals. And even if they do have to come in the front door of our hospitals, hopefully there for a relatively short period of time. And certainly we wouldn't want to see the level of delayed discharge that we're currently seeing at the moment, which I fully accept is far too high. So, important role in terms of funding, important role in terms of third sector public bodies, but also government obviously leads on this agenda, and our own policies, I hope, give some reassurance that this is a top priority for us.
Just one more short question, Convener, if that's okay. So just very, very specifically, Cabinet Secretary, progress in life expectancy has stalled over the last period. And I'm wondering, is there any specific plans to revitalise that progress there? And again, monitor and evaluate that going forward.
Yeah, it has stalled. You'd be right, absolutely, in making that point. I think improving mental health and physical health, which are often linked, obviously. So improving access to opportunities to improve one's own physical health and mental health are going to be clearly critical to that. I think that's why a recovery plan is so important, to be frank, over the last 2 years, because people haven't been able to access services in the way they would have pre-pandemic. There is undoubtedly people are attending our hospitals with higher acuity, deteriorating in terms of their own conditions if they're waiting on waiting lists for too long. If you don't get a CAMHS referral in good time, of course your mental health is in danger of deteriorating. So this preventative space again is integral to our recovery, but the challenges are significant, and that's why the care and wellbeing portfolio, I think, is also hugely important as well. And happy to give you continued updates in terms of how we're evaluating that, because different pieces of that work will be evaluated in different ways. So we've promised to update on the recovery plan, for example, yearly, on funding streams as a different evaluation process. So maybe I can set some of that out in further detail to the committee.
Okay, thank you. For a deeper dive into health inequalities, Carol Mochan.
Thank you. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, obviously, the previous couple of themes have covered this, but the Auditor General was quite critical of the government in terms of its overall strategy for addressing health inequalities, particularly around disability and those from deprived backgrounds, in terms of the pandemic, but very much acknowledged that this is ongoing health inequalities, as we've heard. I'm really keen to find out from the Cabinet Secretary, you know, have they managed to pull together an overarching strategy to look at health inequalities, and what actually are you going to measure? And on top of that, I wonder if the government have considered other measures that it can use, perhaps other powers that it's not currently using within the Scottish Government, to make a difference to what is probably, you know, of the highest importance for the Scottish Government.
So can I recognise from the offset that Ms Mochan has had a consistent interest in the issue of health inequalities, and it's an interest that I share with you too. It goes to the heart of what we're doing right across government. I would commend, in terms of health inequalities, the report I referenced to Ms Mackay, the health inequalities and primary care report, if you haven't seen that, and I appreciate how much paperwork members will see on a daily basis, but we'd be keen to be keen to share that with you, so we'll make sure, if you haven't seen that, we'll pass the link on. But that that report and the recommendations of that report, I think, are really important for government to consider. They provide a really strong basis for dealing with health inequalities in terms of a primary care level, which we know will often be the first port of call. We've obviously invested in community links workers and have promised a further investment in mental health and wellbeing workers in every GP practice as well. In terms of the powers that we have, I won't give you a long list of what we've done, maybe just a short list perhaps, but there is, you know, the work that we've done across portfolios. So if I think about education, think about providing free school meals and early years, the number of hours of free childcare, but particular focus on at-risk and vulnerable young people. If I think about the work we've done in investing in housing and affordable housing, when I think about healthcare, I think about the delivery of a number of preventative programmes and policies that I've mentioned in the public health space. I can think about concessionary travel, free personal care, and so on and so forth. So you're right, this is a cross-government approach in terms of tackling inequalities. I have to be upfront and frank, and I think Ms. Mockin would accept this to some degree, I hope, that there's only so much we can do when we have a UK government that I don't think is adequately addressing the cost of living crisis. I don't think is adequately addressing the issues around fuel poverty, around the energy crisis, and you know, frankly, is a government that it's the passive nature in which it's tackling the cost of living crisis comes in the back of 10 years of really difficult austerity that we had too. So some of these powers are absolutely in my hand, and I'd expect Ms. Mockin to rightly challenge me to go further, to use them more, and so on. And of course, we've often done that. But frankly speaking, there's only so much I can do to mitigate the impacts and effects of decisions that are made elsewhere.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. I mean, obviously, we would agree that the cost of living crisis is very significant, and we don't disagree on the impact from the Westminster Conservative Government, absolutely. But I do thank him for the commitment to look at ensuring we are using all the powers here in Scotland, so that's very helpful. I wonder just one of the last things that the Auditor General had spoken about was the progress of the Public Health Scotland work, and I wonder if you could just give us a little bit of a feedback on how you feel that is going.
Yeah, I think most members, I hope, would recognise the incredible work that Public Health Scotland has done over the course of this pandemic. The amount of data they've provided us, the incredible work they've done right across the range of services that they've provided in relation to their response to the pandemic. But that means that essentially some of the work that we'd wanted Public Health Scotland to do when they were initially conceived or we thought about conceiving Public Health Scotland as an organisation, we never knew we'd be hit by a pandemic. So some of that work has stalled. There's no getting away from that. In my recent conversations with Public Health Scotland, though, I've been pleased that there's been much more of a focus, not entirely pivoting away from the pandemic response, because that's still with us, but certainly being able to pivot slightly away from that pandemic response, given that we are moving into an endemic phase and working more on exactly the type of issues that Ms. Mockin has already raised. So I can give you an absolute assurance that is from the management and the chair that I've spoken to, there's a clear focus for them.
Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. And we have questions on the finance of the NHS. Paul Kane.
Thank you, convener. The Audit Scotland report, Cabinet Secretary, states that the NHS was not financially sustainable before the COVID-19 pandemic, and goes on to talk about the six boards that are requiring additional financial support from the government, or indeed taking non-recurring savings in order to break even. So I wonder if I can start with those six boards in terms of my questions. Is the Cabinet Secretary confident that those boards will be able to achieve financial balance in 2022-23, or is ongoing support likely to be required? And what is his assessment of the issues being experienced by these boards? Is it, you know, weak financial management, or does he think that it's more fundamentally a lack of adequate resourcing?
So the first thing to recognise, I think, in all of this is that when it has come to the response to the pandemic, we've ensured that every single health board has received the support that they've needed and where they've requested additional support, we've been upfront and making that available. But there's no doubt that those boards that were escalated in relation to financial sustainability, where they were escalated prior to the pandemic, the challenges of the pandemic have not made that, I don't think, any easier. So significant support has been provided to the board. I'm not going to give you an absolute in terms of where they'll end up at the end of the financial year, but I think there's going to have to be continued work with those boards in the period ahead. Our aim and ambition in providing that support, of course, is to hopefully see a de-escalation. That's the entire purpose of providing that support. And when they are escalated, of course, the boards, you'll be absolutely aware that we ask for a significant amount of additional reporting than we would for any other health board. I'm confident that they'll de-escalate in good time. But I would also make the point that the pandemic has made that issue of financial sustainability more challenging. I don't know if Richard wants to add anything further in terms of specifics.
Yeah, maybe just a couple of things. As the Cabinet Secretary has said, all boards received additional financial support through the pandemic. It was, you know, we provided that additional funding, you know, costs associated with bed capacity, with the vaccinations programme, etc. All boards received that additional funding. Of the six boards that are mentioned in the Audit Scotland report, three of them were escalated for financial reasons before the pandemic, so Esher and Arran, Borders and NHS Highland. And so the work that we did at the end of 21-22 was really to enhance the financial reporting that those boards did, just to ensure that, given where they were before the pandemic, there was still that ongoing focus on financial recovery. And with the three other boards of those six, NHS Orkney, NHS Dumfries and Galloway and NHS Fife, we'd noticed some differences in terms of their position compared to other territorial boards. So really the approach was to have some of that enhanced reporting, just to be sure that the boards were on track with their financial plans, with very much, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, a view to ensuring that in 22-23 they can deliver the financial plans that they've set out.
Thank you, Convener. And I don't think anyone would deny that the pressures have been exacerbated by the pandemic. I was just pointing to the fact that the audit report does say that there wasn't a financial sustainability prior to that. And I think committee will be keen to hear an update in terms of the progress of those boards I've referenced when we get to financial year end. I wonder if I can, Convener, just perhaps go on to talk more broadly about the increase in funding. Scottish Government committed to a £2.5 billion increase in funding for health and social care. That's over, obviously, the course of the Parliament, but the medium-term financial framework for health and social care has not yet been updated. So in the absence of any medium-term financial framework, how can the Cabinet Secretary be confident that the additional funds committed will actually be allocated and indeed used effectively? And can I also just ask, when will the updated medium financial framework be published?
So the very latter point, we've recognised that it does have to be updated, particularly in light of COVID and some of the challenges that has brought. I don't think we've committed yet to a specific date on when it needs to be published, given that we are just coming out of, you know, the immediate pressures of a pandemic response, given the Omicron and BA2 wave. But we do recognise it needs updated and published. In terms of the resources and demand, the medium term framework, remember, it doesn't set our budget. It gives us an envelope, and then it's for us to prioritise what the budget will therefore look like. That's informed by our key policy priorities and areas, how do we align with the national performance framework, and so on and so forth. In terms of your question, which was around, you know, confidence and the funding and financial fiscal framework moving forward, I would point to a recent joint study by the London School of Economics, LSE, and The Lancet, suggesting that 4% real terms growth in healthcare costs is to be expected to ensure improving quality of care and terms and conditions for health and care workforce. And that's very much in keeping with the underlying assumptions the assumptions that underpin the current medium-term financial framework. So this and other independent research will inform our review moving forward. And in terms of the publication of that medium-term financial framework, as I say, we will update that and we'll publish that, but do so after the resource spending review, which I hope would make sense to most members around this table.
Final questions from Evelyn Tweed before we must wrap up. Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
The Auditor General noted that reforming lines of accountability might encourage more collaborative working across health boards. And he noted individual accountable officers could be measured on delivery of performance in their own organisations as opposed to wider outcomes. Is this something that the Scottish Government is exploring?
I will give it exploration. I think every Auditor General's report into the NHS deserves rightly that consideration. Really keen that we get the balance right between reform, which is exceptionally important in terms of the delivery of service, but also where we can reform governance and accountability, again, really important. But we don't end up so distracted by that that, of course, we get distracted from the immediate pressures that we're under in terms of getting through that backlog, given how long, unfortunately, people have had to wait for various elective procedures. So I think the accountability point is an important one, certainly one that, although I couldn't give a commitment to in terms of what more we might do in relation to the Auditor General's recommendation, is certainly one that is worthy of further consideration.
Thank you, Evelyn. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for all your responses today. We've run out of time, unfortunately, but I thank to you and your officials for the time you spent with us this morning. At our next meeting on the 17th of May, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care will be attending the committee to provide a general update on the social care sector in Scotland. And this follows the publication of Audit Scotland's social care briefing on the 27th of January and the evidence the committee heard on the 22nd of February from a number of stakeholders representing the social care sector. But that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.